Hello everyone, first of all a very happy new year. In this video we'll discuss everything about the e-commerce sector in India and its potentiality and its future prospects vis-a-vis the new e-commerce rules passed by the central government and also the draft e-commerce policy released by the Ministry of Commerce Industry. So first of all we'll see the agenda of this video. The first we will discuss about the e-commerce sector potential in India, and we'll also see the e-commerce policy in India, if at all, if it has any. We'll also see the FDI rules in the e-commerce sector, and we'll see the difference between the inventory and the marketplace model, and the new rules and the draft policy and the way forward for the e-retailing sector in India. The first of all, if you see the discussion, we will start the discussion with the definition of the e-commerce. E-commerce is nothing but the selling of goods or services on an e-commerce platform or a digital platform, where the digital platform might be a TV, mobile, or any internet-enabled application. So ultimately, it is nothing but a platform. It is like a virtual or digital marketplace where the buyers and sellers can meet, or they can showcase their goods so that the buyers, if they are willing, they can buy. So this is the typical example of the e-commerce. If you see the different forms of the e-commerce sectors which exist in India and in general across the world, the first one is B2B. What is this B2B e-commerce websites is? They generally connect one business to other business. The supplier, that means they connect the suppliers with the manufacturers. They connect the MSMEs, that means small scale medium industries, with the large scale industries, that means MNCs. For instance, consider a case of automobile company. Okay, this automobile company needs a lot of spare parts. For that, the procurement can happen from anywhere across India, and not just India but across the world. But let us suppose there is an e-commerce platform where whatever the spare parts these automobile companies sees, they can showcase their spare parts on this e-commerce. So, and the automobile companies, they can quote their prices. In this way, what happens is there will be transparent price discovery will be there. In the same way, the business expansion can happen for these MSMEs, because now they can reach out to larger or more sellers. In the same way, the buyers, that means the automobiles or the MNCs, can get cheap goods and quality goods, because ultimately here the quality is rather important in this B2B. So if you see the second sector, that means B2C, this B2C is nothing but the way the businesses serve the end customer. Typically, this is nothing but where we shop generally and daily in our lives, the Flipkart and the Amazon. They typically sell these all the end products like smartphones, groceries, food items, furniture, everything which are showcased by different sellers on their platform to the end consumers. So this is the another case, another type of e-commerce sector. The second or the other kind of e-commerce is a single brand. In single brand is nothing but where there will be e-commerce website or mobile app, and only the products of a single brand will be showcased there. That means consider IKEA. If it is having an e-commerce website, it will showcase only its products, not everyone's product. So this is the example of the single brand retail. If you see the multi-brand retail, nothing but these websites showcase multiple brands products on their e-commerce sectors. So this, the Amazon and Flipkart, is a typical example of this multi-brand retail. So these are the difficult examples of the B2B. See, this Amazon business is a B2B. See, Amazon is a B2C, Amazon India. Whereas this Amazon business is a B2B platform. In the same way, this Walmart's Best Price is a B2B, where it serves only wholesalers. That means it is nothing but a cash and carry, where the wholesalers who do bulk purchases can only purchase in these markets. In the same way, these Moglix, everything these are all are B2B e-commerce platforms. So if you see the e-commerce aggregators in India, there are e-commerce websites serving different purposes and different customers in different ways in different sectors. For instance, if you see in the tourism, you have these five fields. In the education, this e-commerce is rather known as EduCommerce. For instance, consider the case of an academy. What is generally do? It connects the educators across the world or India with the students or the information seekers. So it is a service-based e-commerce sector. In the same way, the healthcare, entertainment, this Book My Show, it connects the different movie halls with the movie watchers. In the same way, this real estate, home buyers with the home sellers. In the same way, the resale, the OLX, the transport, the Ola and Uber connects the cabs with the cab seekers. So not just the private sector, the government has also recently forayed into this e-commerce sector due to its potential in reaching out to global customers. For instance, see the case of e-Mahilahat, where the empowerment of women can happen. Like for suppose the self-help groups, whatever the goods they produce, they can market on this e-Mahilahat, so they can reach out to larger customers across India and the world. In the same way, the tribal arts and the tribal crafts, they can be showcased on these platforms, the Trifed and the Tribal India portal. So this is the e-commerce aggregators typically working in India. If you see the potential of the e-commerce sector, the Morgan Stanley sees is at $112 billion by 2020. This is just a B2C. Whereas if you include the B2B platform, it is double or thrice of this B2C, because in India, the B2B has more than six times the potential of B2C. Why? Because India is 90% unorganized sector. That means more than 90% of the MSMEs or the, for instance, these MSMEs in the wholesalers, it is on, everything is unorganized. In the same way, retail shops, 90% is unorganized. That means most of the purchases happens through Kirana stores. So everything is unorganized sector. Let us suppose there is a common e-commerce platform. This e-commerce platform connects these small retailers with the consumers. So the consumers will benefit with the quality products and the cheaper prices. These Kirana stores will also be benefited due to the expansion of the buyers. So in this way, e-commerce platform has a huge potential in the B2B and also the B2C sector in India. So if you see the reasons for the growth of the e-commerce sector in India, the first reason is the cheaper smartphones, because the internet is the most essential thing and the digital technology is the most essential thing. As smartphones have become cheaper, it has penetrated into even tier 2, tier 3 and rural India. Not just cheaper smartphones, the thing which has helped the growth of e-commerce sector is the low data tariffs and the better connectivity due to huge investments by the telecom sector companies in India. And the recent revolution in 3G, 4G and the Jio effect has brought this e-commerce sectors into the rural India also. If you see, the Internet Mobile Association of India says the internet penetration will be 60% in 2020. Not just this, the government has also promoting these e-commerce sectors through programs called Digital India and also promotion of digital economy through prepaid payment instruments, UPI, BHIM, etc. So all these are the reasons for the growth of the e-commerce sector in India. If you have to see the concentration of the e-commerce sector in India, most of the big e-commerce companies have been typically concentrating only on metros and large cities because of the huge incomes and urbanization happening. and also due to the awareness and the digital literacy. Digital literacy is more there and the digital awareness is more there. So that's the reason why they have been concentrated on metros and large cities. But due to the digital economy and the digital transactions and the due to the cheaper smartphones and the data tariffs, slowly they are moving towards tier 2 and tier 3. But the presence in rural India is very less due to logistical issues like supply, packaging, everything. But nevertheless, it has also been increasing because of the implementation of a project known as BharatNet project, where it aims to connect or give broadband connectivity to every household in India. So the e-commerce has got a lot of potential for job creation and employment and for the growth of the country in the future. So if you see the rules for foreign direct investment in e-commerce, so these are the four rules. The first rule is India allows 100% FDI under automatic route. So there is automatic, this is 100% FDI automatic. There is no approval needed from the government except small approvals. So it is mostly automatic in nature. But this is only in a marketplace model. But FDI is prohibited in inventory-based model in India. So FDI is allowed 100% in only marketplace model, but not inventory-based model. So what is this marketplace model and inventory-based model? We will see in the further slides. See, this is in B2C. This is in B2C, business to consumers. If you see the B2B e-commerce, that means the business to business e-commerce, India allows 100% FDI in B2B e-commerce. The example is already we have discussed this Walmart Best Price. It is a B2B website, and Walmart is the parent company for this Walmart Best Price wholesale e-commerce shops. So there is 100% FDI is allowed. This 100% FDI is allowed under automatic single brand retail. So in single brand retail, there is 100% FDI. There is no restriction at all. Example, see the Starbucks, IKEA, Puma, everything is, they have their set up their own stores and also their online stores. But if you come to the multi-brand retail sector, no FDI is allowed. So FDI is not at all allowed in the multi-brand retail, both in offline retail and also in online retail, that means e-commerce. So there's a reason why there is no Walmart. Walmart is there, but it is in the B2B platform in the name of Walmart Best Price, but it is not a B2C. That means it is not serving the retail consumers or the end consumers. Rather, it is serving only the MSMEs or the bulk purchasers or the wholesalers in India. There's a reason why the Carrefour, which is the largest retail sector in France, it's not allowed in India. So these are the FDI rules which were there until now. So the reason why this foreign direct investment is not allowed in multi-brand retail is simply because India is 90% unorganized. So due to this unorganized sector, and another reason is more than 14 million MSMEs exist in India. In the same way, the Kirana stores, all these provides a lot of huge employment for the small traders. Huge employment for small traders. So if the FDI is allowed in the multi-brand retail, what happens is it will lead to setup of big supermarkets. Big supermarkets. Already these small scale traders and the shoppers have been facing a stiff competition from the Indian supermarkets like Metro, D-Mart, Big Bazaar and the likes of this. So already huge competition exists for the Kirana stores from the supermarkets. But if the FDI is allowed, it will open the floodgates for these MNCs to establish supermarkets. And these MSMEs and the local Kirana stores, people fear that their employment will be gone. And that is also the reason, because it is a political issue, the governments have not allowed FDI in multi-brand retail until now. So these are the FDI rules. So now if you see what is this inventory model and marketplace model means, already we have seen FDI is not allowed in multi-brand retail. So if you take a typical example of a Flipkart or Amazon, these are B2C e-commerce companies. So what they generally do, there will be a website or a mobile app. On one side you have the sellers, on the other side you have the buyers. So this is nothing but this Flipkart or Amazon acts as a facilitator for the sale. It just acts as a facilitator here. So it also gives supplies such as payments, payment services, payment collection. And the second type is logistics. That means a delivery. It will take care of delivery. The third type is it will take care of packaging. The fourth one is it will take care of warehousing. So these are the facilitation work done by the e-commerce portal. Whereas the sellers or the manufacturers are typically have no role with the e-commerce act. This model of e-commerce is known as marketplace model. So this model is known as marketplace model. Whereas if you see this is the marketplace model. So what the marketplace model says, the marketplace model has been defined as providing an information. So IT platform should be there on a digital, and so it acts just as a facilitator. So that means the e-commerce portal should not own any inventory at all. It should not sell its own goods on its platform. Why? Because if the governments allow the e-commerce portal to own their inventory, what happens is, this is nothing but a backside entry to this multi-brand retail. That means what the Walmart will simply do, the Walmart will establish a e-commerce company in India, and it will sell its own goods and own inventory, which is typically sourced from foreign goods. So that's the reason why the FDI was not allowed in inventory model, but rather the FDI was allowed only in the marketplace model in India. So already we have seen in the marketplace model, the government has allowed the e-commerce marketplace support services in the form of warehouses, logistics. So this is the reason why the government has not allowed the inventory model. So inventory model, as already discussed, the entity owns the inventory of the goods and services and sells directly to consumers. So typical example, if you have to see, the Flipkart was started by Sachin Bansal as a inventory based e-commerce portal. It typically used to sell books on its website. Rather, it has converted itself to marketplace model. Why? Because the government does not allow this inventory model in India. So that's the reason why the FDA is not allowed in the inventory model in the e-commerce sector. So now we will see what is the necessity for the government to pass new regulations. So the necessity for new regulations is because the e-commerce firms have been bypassing the Indian regulations. How they have been bypassing the Indian regulations means, in the first of all, this Amazon and Flipkart, they are owned by foreign persons, because most of this funding comes from foreign based private ventures and the venture capitalist. The second thing what they have done is, so as these are foreign funded, they have been giving preference for foreign goods, and also they are giving preferential treatment to some sellers. That means what is happening here is, what the Flipkart and Amazon has done is, they have gone for policy shopping. What is policy shopping means? To make such adjustments such that the policies can be tweaked. That means, for instance, what the inventory model says, the e-commerce portal should not own any inventory. So, should not own any inventory at all. But what the Flipkart and Amazon has done is they have set up their subsidiaries. For instance, consider Amazon. Amazon has set up a subsidiary known as CloudTail. So Amazon has equity stake in it. And what it has done, now that it's CloudTail, it is a seller on Amazon platform. And to the irony of the small scale sellers on the Amazon platform, the CloudTail selling is more than 70% of Amazon sales in India. So that means only one seller in the form of CloudTail, which is again owned by the Amazon, sells most of the goods on its platform. So this is against the small scale sellers who are selling the on the Amazon platform. In the same way, if you see Aperio Retail, when again the Amazon has equity stakes in and it is one of the biggest sellers. So in a way, what they have bypassed the, because they can't own the inventory, what they have done is they have set up their subsidiaries and they own their inventories and they have become the sellers. In a way, ultimately here the Amazon is the owner of that inventory. So it is nothing but a policy shopping and bypassing the Indian regulations. In the same way, the Flipkart and the WS Retail. This WS Retail is a subsidiary of the Flipkart, and the Flipkart bypassed these rules of inventory based model through establishment of this WS Retail. But ultimately this WS Retail was shutted down in August of this 2018. Why? Because the Enforcement Directorate and Income Tax are getting ready to investigate the Bansal so in this fraud. So this is the one of the frauds being done by the e-commerce firms in India. And other few frauds which are associated with this current practices of these firms is, first one is tax evasion. How they are going for tax evasion in India is, see, for the small sellers on the Amazon platform, 20% commission is charged from the regular sellers, whereas only 5% commission is charged by the Amazon. See, one Amazon and Flipkart, they are marketplace models. So how they gain revenues or profits? They charge commissions from the sellers for placing their goods on its platform. So for the small scale sellers, the commission is 20%, whereas for this CloudTail, it is only 5%. That means what the Amazon will do? The Amazon will pay only tax on this 5% and remaining 15% it goes as Amazon's profits, but ideally the CloudTail should pay 20%. So this is nothing but tax evasion. Second reason is discriminatory practices. What is discriminatory practices? Means because it charges less commission from the other, from its subsidiaries, and more from other online sellers, what it is doing, it's nothing but discrimination and anti-competitive nature. Because in India, we have Competition Commission of India. The competition is very much essential for the survival of any sector. If there is no competition, it will lead to monopoly. So discriminatory practices should not be allowed at all. So the third reason what they have been doing is they are bypassing the Indian laws and regulatory overlays. Already we have seen that they are becoming non-compliant with FDA rules. So this is the third reason. The fourth reason is the predatory pricing. What is this predatory pricing means? They are giving deep discounts. They are giving deep discounts, leading to problems for brick and mortar firms in India. How they are able to give deep discounts? Because they are funded by foreign private equity investments. So what their business model is, first of all, give discounts hugely and attract the customers so that all the small scale sellers will close down, and ultimately it will lead to monopoly. So this predatory pricing is not at all good for the sector as a whole. The second, the fifth point here is the setback for the startup India. India has a startup policy to promote startups in India, but ultimately in the 2014 there used to be more than 200 e-commerce companies, but now there are less than 100 e-commerce companies. Why? Because the e-commerce sector has been largely dominated by two companies, Amazon and Flipkart, because they are being deeply subsidizing by the foreign firms. So this is what it has led to. It has led to closure of Indian companies. Last one is grievance redressal and consumer protection. So these firms or these online marketplaces sometimes give rise to frauds, and there is no effective grievance redressal mechanism to take care of these complaints. So these are the few problems associated with these e-commerce firms. So because of the above said problems, so the government has come out with a new e-commerce rules to set right the e-commerce industry in India. So if you see the new e-commerce rule, the first rule is any warranty or guarantee on goods and services sold will be the responsibility of the seller, not the marketplace operator. So the marketplace operator should not be the person responsible for warranty or guarantee on goods and services. So it should be the responsibility of the seller. The second one is an e-commerce firm will not be permitted to sell more than 25% of total sales from one vendor or its group companies. So what it says is, let us take Amazon. There is a seller. Let us suppose again Cloudtail. Of all the sales of Amazon, the Cloudtail cannot spend more than 25. Sales should not be more than 25. Okay. If it is more than 25, it will be taken as inventory. Amazon owning the inventory, and it will be against the FDA rule in India. So any one single vendor should not sell more than 25% of their sales on one e-commerce platform. This is again, this rule was made to close the doors for the companies like Amazon and Flipkart to use these subsidiaries. The third rule is prohibition of marketplaces from offering discounts. We know these marketplaces offer huge discounts. So now, offering of discounts is the responsibility of the sellers, but not the marketplaces. So in the future, we might not be seeing these big days like which the Flipkart and Amazon usually do. The fourth rule is online marketplaces will not be allowed to directly or indirectly influence pricing of the products. So already we have discussed it. So there will be no influence of the marketplaces. So if you see the other rule, the e-commerce firms were prohibited from selling products in which they or group companies have equity stake in company manufacturing them. Let us suppose there is a company X. It produces some good. And let us suppose Amazon owns some equity in this, then that company X will be banned or prohibited from selling its goods on Amazon. Again, this provision was made to ensure that Amazon doesn't or the Flipkart doesn't go for policy shopping. The next one is exclusive deals were prohibited. So what is this exclusive deals means? If you see the next point, we'll discuss this. No seller can sell its products exclusively on any marketplace platform. Like let us suppose there is an Oppo smartphone or the Xiaomi. They want to release a new smartphone into the Indian market. What they generally typically do is they do flash sales on one e-commerce platform, but with the new rules this is not permitted. Why? Because exclusive deals were prohibited, and also the one seller cannot sell his products exclusively on one marketplace platform. So in the future, these flash sales of one smartphone going on one e-commerce website will not be allowed at all. So this is the other rule. The last rule is all vendors on e-commerce platform should be provided services in a fair and transparent non-discriminatory manner. So we have discussed the discriminatory practices followed by these companies. So the new rules prohibits these non-discriminatory practices. So these are the new rules passed by the government. So now we will see the impact of the new e-commerce rules on this sector. So the positive impact will be, this is expected to level the playing field with offline retailers who are unable to compete with online retailers deep discount. So this Amazon Flipkart, they have been subsidized by the foreign private equity firms. They're able to give deep discounts, and this is hurting the offline retailers and also the other Indian e-commerce websites, for instance Snapdeal, etc. All these have gone for job cuts due to the onslaught of the competition of these two firms. So majorly these newcomers, new rules were aimed at Amazon and Flipkart. The second positive was it was promoted Indian e-commerce firms. So already we have discussed the Startup India project. So the new rules will give boost to Indian e-commerce firms and create jobs and prevent national wealth from exporting. Already we have seen this tax evasion and the profits by the foreign persons. So all the new rules will ensure that Indian e-commerce firms will grow, the startups will come in the tier 2 and tier 3, the jobs will come in the India. If you see the negative of this rules is, the first one is, it's a form of Swadeshi or the protectionist policy. So why it is protectionist policy means, it is encouraging Indian firms, and it is not allowing FDI in India. It's not allowing FDI in India in inventory based model. So already USA has opposed this provision of the new e-commerce rules. The second negative will be, it hinders foreign investment in India because the FDI will become, FDI norms are tightened now. And also the doing business will be very difficult because ultimately India aims to achieve this rank of top 50 in the EvoDB world rankings of the World Bank. Now with these provisions, it might become difficult for the e-commerce firms and their foreign investors to do business in India due to these policy uncertainties happening. The other negative will be, it prevents companies from gaining benefits out of economies of scale. What is this economies of scale? Because even though the Flipkart and Amazon, they have given rise to the closure of a few companies and lost of jobs, but this, because of these companies, a lot of jobs and employment have been generated because they were able to achieve the economies of scale. What is this economies of scales means? As they served across the India, they were able to establish logistics chain, warehousing, packaging and everything in a sorted out and organized manner. But with the new rules, it becomes very difficult to own the inventory, and they have to serve only as a marketplace models. The small e-commerce firms will find it difficult to organize this logistics and warehouse sector. So in a way, the new rules might turn out to be a negative for the logistics and warehouse sector for India. So if you see the evaluation of the marketplace model of e-commerce, so we have seen the inventory model and the marketplace model. Now we will see which type of model is suited for India. So if you evaluate the marketplace model of e-commerce, what happens in the marketplace model is, the sellers are responsible for product quality. Ultimately, the e-commerce platform, it is only a facilitator. So it can't watch for the authenticity of the product or the good or the quality of the good. So it is dependent only on the sellers. The second platform is where these platforms do not have full control over the supply chain. Again, as the e-commerce is only a facilitator, they won't invest in logistics, warehousing, packaging, everything at all, and also delivery. So it becomes the sole responsibility of the seller for all these things. So it might turn out to be a constraint for the small scale sellers. Sometimes we also see in place of smartphones, bricks being delivered. Why? Because these e-commerce platforms, they are just only facilitators. This is the reason why sometimes we see bricks also. The third is there is no effective mechanism for grievance redressal and consumer protection. That is it being a marketplace model. This facilitator, it only watches for the payments, collection, everything. So the if the customer has any problem with this payment collection, the e-commerce website will be responsible. But for the product quality and the IPR loss, it has no role. So again, this is one of the drawbacks. Another drawback is, in the marketplace model, there won't be any oversight over the IPR violations in case of seller products. So again, there will be no control over the products in this platform. What it typically, it can lead to IPR violations, like copyright violations, etc. The next point is, this model also does not attract huge foreign investments into warehousing and the logistics sector. Why doesn't it? Because ultimately, by serving as a marketplace model, there won't be huge profits in the this sector. So ultimately, the foreign investments won't be invested investing in this marketplace model. So in a way, it inhibits these foreign investments into the warehouse and logistics sector. So this is the reason why Amazon pledged to invest billions of dollars, and recently Walmart has bought Flipkart for $16 billion. The reason why they have pledged to invest this much of amount in India is because ultimately they know that they will be converted from marketplace model to inventory model. That's the reason why they have been investing huge money, because they know that they, in the future, they can make big money. But with the new rules, it becomes very difficult for them to move to the inventory based model in India. So it acts as a setback for these companies. So with this idea, should India allow inventory based model means, now if you evaluate the inventory based model, what it will do is, it leads to heavy investments in procurement, warehousing, logistics, sorting, packaging. Why? Because here ultimately the e-commerce portal will have control over the entire supply chain, because it owns the inventory. So it will lead to huge investments. Secondary thing is, it also leads to accountability and regulatory oversight is easy. Why? Because is now the e-commerce portal is responsible for everything across the supply chain. The third point is, this inventory based model promotes investments in food processing. How it promotes food process investments in food processing means, now as the e-commerce portals, they own the inventory, they aim at brand building. So because of this brand building, they will concentrate on quality. So because of the quality, what these let us take a food product, this e-commerce portal will enter into contracts with the farmers to get raw material. So the farmers can get better prices for their products and also assured crop buying will be there for the farmers. So in a way, the contract farming will happen and the food processing technology and the investments will come because of this inventory based model. If you see the Chinese model of, because China is a huge leader in e-commerce, and its success was majorly due to, it was a inventory led model. Of course, this inventory led model was entirely to homegrown companies. China does not allow any foreign based e-commerce portal into its country. The entire e-commerce industry in China was controlled by homegrown companies, and they are inventory based model. For instance, your Alibaba. So if India wants to replicate the Chinese growth of e-commerce, it might have to re-strategize its e-commerce rules. Why? Because if you see the Chinese model, it was majorly to inventory led model. But one of the negatives of this inventory based models is, it may lead to foreign brands flooding Indian markets and hurting the small retailers and MSMEs. So these are the major constraints to allow inventory based model in India. But this model can be, or the this impact can be reduced by making rules such that the companies or the e-commerce firms should be made to procure locally. So the rules can be made like procure locally, some amount local procurement. The second one is compulsory buying from India. So if the government can make rules like this, it will benefit both small retailers, MSMEs, and also the entire industry. So India should re-strategize its new rules on the e-commerce portals. So with this idea, we will see whether India has any policy on e-commerce until now. So until now, India does not have any national policy on e-commerce. So with this idea, the government has established a task force headed by the Commerce Minister Suresh Prabhu. And recently, this committee has submitted this draft national policy in e-commerce. So if you see what are the key recommendations of this committee, the committee has recommended that inventory model FDI can be allowed. So until now there is no FDI allowed inventory model. This committee recommended that inventory model FDI should be allowed, but only until 49%, not 100%. But it has also set a condition. That condition is that whatever the e-commerce portal should sell 100% made in India. That's what I am talking about. So if the e-commerce portal is made to procure locally and sell only made in India products, so ultimately the Indian farmers, Indian MSMEs, Indian retailers, Indian traders will benefit. So in a way, this is a key recommendation for the growth of e-commerce and other sectors in India. It also recommended that the e-commerce firms should to offer their own brands as long as they are made in India. So again, earlier the new rules has stated, no e-commerce company should sell a product in which it has stakes. So again, what this recommendation is aimed at brand building of the e-commerce, but again, they should be only made in India. So this was again a good recommendation. The next recommendation is a foreign e-commerce website should be brought on a level playing field with the Indian counterparts. That means Indian e-commerce websites and the foreign e-commerce websites should be brought on a level playing field so that the cross-border e-commerce trade will become easy. Cross-border e-commerce trade. The other recommendation is a marketplace rules for. So whatever the rules were recommended in the marketplace model, they were already implemented and we have already seen these rules. Some of the recommendations are in the consumer protection. What they have said is a forum for consumers should be established and that should be known as a Central Consumer Protection Authority. What this authority will do is any fraudulent activities done by the sellers or the e-commerce websites, the consumers can report to this platform so that there will be instant justice. And this Central Consumer Protection Authority also will also act as a coordination mechanism of between different governmental departments. So this is one of the key recommendations in the for consumer protection. Other recommendation is establish a separate wing in ED to see if there are any FDA norms violations by these e-commerce firms. The other recommendation in payment systems is, see, ultimately e-commerce websites have given rise to a lot of rise in digital transactions and digital payments. But ultimately, most of the e-commerce websites allows cash on delivery. So to promote digital transactions, what the committee has recommended is, it has recommended the inclusion of government's RuPay payment systems on all e-commerce platforms. So every e-commerce platform should have a mechanism for payment through RuPay cards. The second one is to take care of the digital frauds and to detect the frauds beforehand. An AI-based authenticated fraud intelligence mechanism should be established to check the digital payment frauds. The other recommendation of the committee is protection of user data with e-commerce firms. See, already the Sri Krishna committee has submitted it a data privacy bill. So now due to the Article 21 making right to privacy a fundamental right, user data or the right to privacy is very important. So what the committee has mandated is all the e-commerce firms should store the data of the Indian consumers within the India itself. So the data should be stored within India itself. And it also said that all e-commerce portals should explain the data collection policy in a simplified and easy understandable manner to these to their users. So there should be a clear mention of the usage of the data collected by the e-commerce firms, and the users will have the ultimate say how to utilize them. These are the few key recommendations made by the Suresh Prabhu committee aimed at making the e-commerce sector a huge job potential in India. So with this idea, we can conclude today's class. Thank you.